Hello. So here's an old interview with Leon Brinkman, maker of Coastline to Atmosphere, Strider Mountain, Final Project Diary, and The Closure, a bunch of other stuff. It was recorded in November 2010 and seems a little bit amateurish now. Sound quality's okay, but it's not perfect. And specifically, we talk about Final Project Diary. So if that's of interest, stay tuned. Hello and welcome to another Planet Philip interview. With me today, I have Leon Brinkman. Leon, how are you?
I'm fine. Hello.
Good. It's been a long time since we've spoken. Probably the last interview was for Strider Mountain, I think.
Yes. Yes. I'm throwing something at my cat. Wait. One second. I can sometimes start to pick in his foot, and then he makes a big mess and noise. So now I'm all yours.
All right, okay.
The last time that we spoke, well, there was the podcast 17 interview, and after that I didn't have any interview anymore, I believe.
Yeah, no, it's been a long time. So you've been very busy since the last time we've spoken, no, that's for sure.
Yes.
I mean, you made something called the Final Project Diary, and that's been released. And what's been the general reception for that?
Oh, shut up. Sorry, it's always like this. Well, at first the comments were good, and then there was a day or two where the comments were not that good. People thought it was, yeah, it was too hyped too much, but we didn't hype it at all. But people think that quite soon when you show a few screens or show a movie of it, then they say you are hyping it. But especially the last 10 comments or so on your site, Planet Philip, were great.
Yeah, no, I mean, generally people seem to have liked it. I mean, I wouldn't agree that it's been hyped. I mean, you kept quite a low profile, you posted the things every now and again. It's not like some of the other mods that are doing these monthly or weekly updates. I mean, you
Daily.
just, yeah, sometimes daily. I mean, you just got down to work and you worked at it.
Well,
What a.
we did
Sorry.
that especially because after Strider Mountain, also a lot of people thought that was hyped. And then we thought, well, let's just work on it. And when it's nearly finished, then, or in the meantime, we can do one or two updates. And then we can show it when it's finished. So it wasn't hyped at all, indeed.
No, it's good. So what about the number of downloads? How many downloads do you think you've had from it?
Well, about 1,000. I was hoping it would be a bit more, about 2 or 3,000. I expected before the release that it would be now, but around 1,100 or so, it's downloaded now.
All right, and I mean that's from all of the different sites you reckon.
Yeah, it's on two sites, on yours and on oh no, or free, and then on Mods Online. Of on ModDB and on the server of Baltic. But the
Is that the cat or your girlfriend?
Yeah, he's now licking the microphone.
Wants to join in. Okay. All
Yeah.
right. So, I mean, how many downloads did Coastline to Atmosphere get? I mean, that had nearly like 100,000, didn't it?
More about, I know of about 140,000 or something, but there are a lot of other servers, so I guess it will be around 180 or 200,000. Yeah,
That's a lot
that's
of.
amazing.
Yeah, it is. All right, now, I thought you said that Strider Mountain was going to be your last mod. What happened?
Yeah, well, it's after Strider Mountain was released, like I said in Final Project, I'm a bit addicted to mapping, and that is really true. I like to map every day for a few hours at least. So when Strider Mountain was finished, I had nothing to do, and in the mean and we were talking about what kind of game we could use next for mapping. So and in the meantime, I wanted to map something, so I thought, well, just make a few maps for the fun of it with episode two of with Half-Life episode one again, and then there was the thing of that you that people donated on your site money for my video card. So I wanted to thank the people, and also for that I wanted to make a few maps.
So, what was the original idea for Project Diary?
Well, at first it was not a really original idea. It was just, I had a few ideas, but like thanking the people who did donate money for the video card. Then I had always some ideas about mapping that I never used in all the previous mods that I still wanted to make in a few maps. And then there was some horror scene that I wanted to implement in a mod, so that could also be done final. Because also first it was called the working title was Final Horror, but because
Okay.
already quite soon I noticed that I couldn't fill about 10 maps with horror. I didn't have enough horror ideas for that, so that was then changed to Final Project, also because it was the final project that I would do for or with Half-Life.
Okay, all right. Now, some readers may not know that Baltic Forever has been working with you for a long time and may not even know what he does, so we wouldn't want to leave him out. I mean, tell us about Baltic Forever a little bit.
Yeah, I'm glad that you mentioned his name, because a lot of people will indeed maybe not know about his influence in all the mods. And his part is very big, but mostly behind the scenes, you could speak. He's very technical in things. And when I didn't know how to make something, or when I could not fix something, then I always could ask him, and he always could fix things. And also, he was the first guy who tested the maps. Later on, there were other testers too, like Jasper and TB Biggs. But yeah, it's always like this. I map, and then I show it to him, what he thinks of it, and he gives him his influence in it. And also when I have problems, and when you map, there are a lot of problems that you have to overcome, and he always helps me with that. So you could speak that we make that our influence is 50-50.
Okay, all right. I mean, it's perhaps the longest running modding partnership.
Probably because we started out in 2002, I think, with Soldiers of Fortune 2.
Okay, so 8 years is a long time, huh? To be working
Yes.
together. It's like a marriage.
Yeah, you could say that. We speak, well, we type each day comments to each other on his forum.
Okay.
We never use chat programs because I'm not fond of them, and he also, I believe. So,
Okay.
but we have daily contact, and it's always about new ideas or mods or maps, or now we're thinking about making a new game, although we don't think we will do that because it's too difficult. Mainly
Okay.
for two people, it's mainly impossible to do.
Well, we're going to come on to that, but what did he say when you said you wanted to make the final project? Did he scream and say, "No, not another one?"
Well, I already had started it, so it was just here is another mod, and well, like I
Was
said, we were.
he enthusiastic at the beginning, or did he need a little convincing?
No, because he knows he knows much more from the engine and the editor as that I do, and I believe that he even wants to carry on a bit with Half-Life 2 mapping.
Oh, good.
After we go on with another mod for another game, because he knows the engine now so well that it's a shame to not do anything anymore with that knowledge.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you and I spoke a long, long time ago about tutorials.
Yeah.
And many readers probably don't know that that's how the original Strider Mountain idea started. That the idea was to make a small mod and then use that mod as a tutorial base for his new website. But Strider Mountain just got bigger and bigger, and that didn't happen. But
Yeah, that's true. I did forget about that, but that's true. Yeah.
I
Now
mean,
the Half-Life 2 community is now much smaller and will get smaller over time because yeah, the game is now nearly 7 years old.
yeah. But
And
hopefully, episode 3 will revitalize the modding industry. Well, not
yeah,
the industry, but the community.
I hope so too, but I'm not sure if an episode will do that. When they come on with Half-Life 3, then it will all be new again, but a new episode. Because I personally was quite, how you say that, disappointed in the episodes. When you buy them, it's quite a lot of money for what you get.
Yeah.
you play it quite soon, you finish it, and the new things in it, there are only a few new models, and maybe one or two new enemies, and that's it. For the rest, it's all Half-Life 2, you could say.
Yeah, true. But you did eventually make the mod for Half-Life 2. Why was that?
At the time, I didn't... When we made for Final Project, you
yes.
mean?
Yes, yes.
Well, at the time that I started it, I didn't own Episode 2. So I could only choose for Episode 1, or I call it a Half-Life. And... For Half-Life 2, of course.
Yes. But you moved over. Why did you move over?
Oh, yeah, that was it. well, the stupid update from Steam, they spoiled so much. And you couldn't even choose between... It was just one day I started my computer and Steam started to update. And boom, there was the update. And you couldn't go back to the previous version. It was just that new engine, especially the first 3 weeks or so. There were so many bugs, and nobody knew what to do with them, and Valve didn't answer any mails, so it was just, we get stuff through our throats. Yeah, that's the right expression.
Did you consider actually just giving up and stopping?
Well, I was quite confused and frustrated in those few weeks. And I was very, very, very angry at Valve. And I've told it on many forums also, like a lot of other people, that I do understand why they do it like they do, but you can't go, you can't treat your community like that. It's not done.
No, I agree. Okay, yeah. So how long did it take to make all together?
Final Project, huh?
Yeah.
Well, when just before the update, we were nearly finished. There were a few less maps, I believe 8. And that was about 8 months or so, I think. And then came the update, and then we had to change everything and, well, redo a lot of things, and then I got new ideas again. So in total, I think we worked about 12, 13 months or something on it.
So did you completely rebuild all of the maps from scratch after the update?
I've mentioned that here and there, but that's of course not true. But especially in the first weeks, there were a lot of problems. I don't know exactly what the problems were. A few I do remember, because, for instance, custom-made models with animations, they didn't work. Custom voice acting didn't work. And so were a few other things that we first had to figure out how to fix them, because nobody knew.
Okay.
And finally, when we knew them, then we had to fix them. And then, yeah.
Okay. So how much did you leave out of the mod? I mean, are there maps and ideas that are still lying on your computer somewhere?
Two maps I left out. Also, where there did I leave out a few parts, because, well... It's silly, but when I start mapping, I can't control myself. I keep on... it's silly for words, but it's really true. When I start mapping until my computer says, or the program, the editor says, you can't go on, then there is, of course, a limit to what you can put in one map in the Hammer editor.
Yes.
And always I just didn't realize how far the map was grown. And then the map was too big for low-end computers, and also sometimes for the editor itself. And then I had to cut a map in two. And then I had two parts, one with an end, and the other one with the end, a start and an end to it. But then I had to make an end and a start also to... Do you understand? You know?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. So you had to cut them up and...
Yeah, and then sometimes I took two parts and linked them together from different maps. So I left out, I believe, 2 or 3 small map parts that I couldn't implement anymore in somewhere else.
Okay. Have you ever considered releasing them as little standalone maps?
Well, I lost them because of a hard disk failure.
Oh, that's a shame. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Backup. I know, but sometimes you just work and then poof, your computer stops, because my computer did crash 3 months ago or so. And then my video card and my hard disk was broken. Wow, you my video card and my power supply was broken, so I had to buy...
Because you use it so much, Leon, that's why you're like whipping them. If you were like a slave master, you'd be standing over them with your whip.
I guess, yeah, especially with those programs. I mean, you have a very big map made in Hammer, then it's quite... the computer has to work hard for it, so yeah, that's true.
Okay, so if you were going to make the final project again, if I had my time machine and I could say, look, Leon, we're going to go back 12 months... And we're going to make it again. What would you do differently?
Oh, I think it would be a totally complete different mod. I would do a lot of things different. And yeah, it would be two complete different mods then. Yeah, I never make something the same. Because when you have something made, that progress is very nice. Mm-hmm. But when it's done, then it's done. For instance, that people make... a map for, say, Half-Life, and then later on they make the same map or maps for Half-Life 2. I never could do that. It would be very boring for me to make exactly what I already had made. It's no fun, no excitement anymore.
No, sure. But, I mean, would you keep the basic idea of the mapper at his desk, or would you just say, okay, I'm just going to do what I do, which is make maps?
No, I would... use that idea from a mapper at work much more, because in fact the story of Final Project is very small. You can put it together in a few lines of text, and that many people did read so much in it was really astonishing to me, because I never thought of those things when I made it. So I would make much more out of the, but that was I. Especially at the beginning of Final Project, you have some kind of story development, but later on, after map 4 or 5, there is no real story anymore. It's just going on, and that was because the custom voice acting didn't work anymore because of the update, so we had to fix what we already had made till then. And I was so afraid that there would be next week again an update that would spoil everything, so... I thought I'd just make what can't be spoiled by an update. And custom voicemail and custom animations, well, that we didn't do anymore. So that's why the story just ends after map 4 or 5.
Okay, so it was a conscious decision that we don't want to do any more work that will be wasted.
Yeah, after that update, I just had something from we have to put... together and fix as many bugs as possible, and then release it before a next update is coming, because there will be a next update, and this was also not the first update from Steam that did destroy things.
Yeah.
Many years ago we had that one update that made maps completely black, that you couldn't see anymore in maps, and a lot of other corrupt things.
On a recent Podcast 17 episode, we discussed your work, and I said it's possible that, for Source anyway, you've released more maps and mods with actual playtime than Valve has. Have you thought about that before?
Yeah, well, a lot of times I did read in comments that many people thought that one mod was already longer than Half-Life 2 or so. And, well, when you... Not with Final Project, but especially with Strider Mountain and Coastline to Atmosphere... I think there is some truth in that.
I think so. I think so. When you add up the episode times and you add up Half-Life 2, I think you've got more playtime.
Yeah.
So that's quite an interesting achievement. So well
done. Also qua map space, you could say, because like I said, my maps are always as large as possible. And I think that you could see one map as two maps from Half-Life and the size they use for their maps.
Yeah, it could be. Could be.
Yeah.
Now, of all the players who have criticised your work, I've probably been the most vocal. But I hope you know that I like and respect very much you and what you do. But my main two criticisms are that you put quantity over quality and that you don't beta test enough. How would you respond to those points?
Yeah, well, I can only say you are true. That's a true fact. About the beta testing with Final Project, we did test it at least 10 times more or with more people at least than the previous mods. And it's true but the thing is, good testers are not easy to find. A lot of people say, well, let me test, and then they play it once, and then they say, well, a nice map, I like it, or something. Well, that's not constructive.
No, not at all.
Also, you have to play, or you have to test at least a map 3-4 times, and each time when something is fixed, then you have to test it again. And a lot of people don't want to do that. And then there is the thing of trust. Like you maybe know, and I mentioned earlier, years ago, that there was one time a guy who wanted to test a map or a few maps of mine, and later on he did send them to friends, and well, you could expect that they come on the internet. And then I didn't even had released that map pack. So I'm quite anxious to just send my maps to someone and to let them test.
People that you trust.
Yeah, you have to. You first have to build a trust, and well, and that can only be done by testing. So, at one point, I just have to say, well, here are the maps, but you have to be careful. Yeah.
Yes, of course. But I mean, you tested Final Project Diary much more than any other mod you've built. Did that cause you problems?
No. In fact, each time I was amazed and someone said, well, this is not good, or there is something missing or whatever. And then I was amazed that I didn't notice that myself. But when you're mapping, at the end of the day, after mapping, I play it once. And when someone gets to test the map, then I have played that map at least 200 or 300 times. So you get blind for some things. You just run through them and focus on what you have just made. And it's heel silly, very silly, but a lot of things you don't notice anymore.
No, it's the same with just writing. You write something and then you proofread it yourself and you give it to somebody else and they find lots of mistakes and you think, how did I not see those? But when you're creating it, it is different. But, I mean, did you find that because there were more problems in the previous maps, it caused you a lot more work, or were you quite happy for that?
No, everything that the testers were saying was something that had to be changed or whatever. So I rather hear it then, after the release, because then you can't do anything anymore, or you can patch it, but that's not something that I like.
No, it's not the same. What about my point about quantity over quality? How do you respond to that?
Well, yeah, that's a point that. You can agree or disagree on. When I make maps, I make them like how I would like to play them, and I rather play say 10 maps that have that are average but still good, or that I play 2 maps that are very good but that only give 10 minutes of gameplay. I like to give players a lot of time. Of game time with fun and action, and not just one great map that they can finish in 10 minutes or so. So you have to choose between quality and quantity. And I try to do it a bit of both. So it's not only quantity, because you can make 100 maps in a week time and it's all rubbish. And well, that's silly. So I try to make the maps as good as possible. But still not overdo it, not sit work 4 months on one map or so. That it has to be releasable in 1 or 2 years max.
Okay, fair enough. Now, going back to Final Project Diary, you implemented a system where people could choose between easy and hard. What was the thinking behind that?
Yeah, and also the system for the puzzle solutions I added in there.
Yeah, we're going to talk about those later. Let's focus on the easy and hard first, though.
Okay. Well, always when with earlier mods, there were always people that didn't like it because there was too much action, too many enemies, and in a lot of comments you could read there were waves of enemies, and that is true. I personally like to play hard, but I thought with the last Half-Life mod, let me try to make it so that also people who don't like too much enemies still will like to play them. So I thought, what can I do? I can make some kind of system that people can, in each map, can press a button or walk somewhere, and then they choose for much more enemies. Because some people commented on, or they asked why I did edit, and they only thought that it would enhance the difficulty, but that doesn't do it, because that system you already have in the game itself, you know, easy, normal, and hard. Mm-hmm. But with this system, it doesn't make the enemies harder, it just makes them more enemies and less health and battery packs around.
Okay, so there's no basic changes to the system itself. You just put more enemies in and less health.
Yeah. More enemies and it was so. More enemies and less health packs.
Okay, so essentially there are six levels of difficulty. You have the original, easy, normal, and hard, and within each of those, you've got the easy and hard as well. Does that make sense?
Yeah. You can just choose for more or less enemies, and then of course the normals difficulty setting that you already used are used to use. Dus personally, I always play on normal.
Okay, I mean, was there any special reward for finishing on hard for the normal difficulty setting, and then hard within the mod? Was there any special prize or Easter egg or anything?
No, it's funny that you mentioned, because I have been thinking about it, but it was already quite a task to implement this system. It's really a quite easy system. You just place one trigger somewhere who will spawn a lot of enemies later on, or make other triggers triggerable so that they can spawn later on. That sounds easy, but when you have to implement it in a map, it was quite confusing at times. So I was thinking about some extra prize or Easter egg, but then it would be too difficult. And like I said already, I tried to not make it more difficult and just release it as soon as possible, because you never know for the next update.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay. I mean, the help system that you mentioned that we're talking about now, I mean, I really liked that idea of giving players a chance to solve a puzzle, but if after a period of time they haven't, then you give them the option of helping. What was the... who thought of that?
I did.
Okay, well done. It was a good idea.
But personally, I'm not so much a puzzle fan. In Half-Life 2 itself, I like the puzzles. But in the mods later on that I played from other people, there were sometimes puzzles that I simply couldn't solve. And after 5-6 times of really trying, and then quitting, and then the next day trying again, well, then for me the fun was over, and then it started to get frustrating. So I thought, when I add puzzles in this last mod, let me make a system that people who don't like puzzles, or people who can't solve it, just choose for the option of watching the solution or how to get somewhere that the puzzle is fixed.
Okay. Was it difficult to implement?
No, it was quite easy. It was just... the only little bit difficult thing was that I had to think of where and after how much time the solution would come on screen, because when it's too quick, or when people just by accident walk into it, then they already see the solution, and maybe they don't want to see the solution at all, or yet. So I had thought of the system that when you try to solve a puzzle and you can't find the solution, then you start walking around normally, I guess, at least I do. And so I thought of a way that when people walked somewhere to the end of, say, a large hallway, then came back and then walked again to the end of the hallway, then there would be the solution. And that was sometimes a bit difficult to implement, but other than that, it was quite easy to implement.
So it wasn't to do with how long they waited for the puzzle, it was more to do with how they moved within the area.
Yeah. Because I thought of how, because it's quite easy to make a trigger with some time setting on it, or you have to use another entity then for that. But that's quite easy. But maybe someone goes to the toilet in the meantime, and then his minutes are already over, you know. So it's better than that he just walks around, and when he comes twice on two places again, then you could say, well, he has had enough time to walk around and think about the solution. And then I offer the solution somewhere in the shape of some icon that was bumping up and down.
Okay.
And then even then the player had the choice to walk into it or not to walk into it and go on with trying to solve it himself.
Okay. Did you try various ways of informing the player? I mean, I didn't particularly like the way I was told that there was this huge, I think it was a diamond, No, two Vs. It was two Vs jumping up and down. And yep. I felt that something could have been a little bit more subtle that made me feel as though it was part of the game. But did you try different ways of informing the player that a solution was available?
Well, yes. First, of because sometimes you're very close to the those two jumping up and down Vs. Mm-hmm. But in other maps, you're, there is a large distance between you and that sign. So it has to be rather large to be able to see it also in on a great distance. But when I had used it for several maps, then I didn't like it that much anymore. And then I noticed that there was in Hammer a model that was turning around. Maybe you've seen it somewhere in other maps of mods. That it is a sort of balloon of a cartoon book. That when you speak, you know, in a cartoon book, then you have some text balloon above you.
We call it a speech bubble.
Ah, yeah, a speech bubble. And that was, there is a model in Half-Life 2 that that you can use for that. And then you can add a trigger to it, and then you can make whatever you want out of it. But I thought of using that later on. But you can't use two different signs. First the double V's and later on that sign. So okay. Then I had to take out everything from the first maps again. And, well, that was too much work. So I thought, well, then I just keep the two bumping V's. But when I had seen that other model before I choose for the double V's, then I would have chosen that speech bubble.
Yeah, I mean, that one's used in the commentary. Is that the one you mean? When you play Half-Life or Half-Life 2, you can choose commentary.
Yeah, that's the one.
That's the one. All right, okay.
Yeah.
I like the choice of stealth or action. You put that in there, and that was a really nice thing. Why did you include that?
You mean in the in map 9, the map before the last map?
Or honestly, I couldn't remember, but it was very near the end, that's for sure.
Yeah, well, that's a part. Well, to be honest, that whole scene was already made in Coastline to Atmosphere.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, some people recognized it, and other people, they didn't. Well, I can imagine that after years you don't recognize that again. So I did just copy-paste it, actually, because I did like that part very much. But I also knew already... Are you still there?
Yes, I'm still here.
Oh, yeah, my cat is walking again over the keyboard. but because of the comments on Coastline to Atmosphere, I knew that a lot of people were not able to complete that stealth mission. And you really have to know exactly where to walk, when and how, otherwise you can't get through it. So I thought, well, this is when... There is one part in the mod that needs an explanation or puzzle solution, then it's that part. And I can imagine that a lot of people will even think, well, I don't want to stealth this whole part at all. Just give me a weapon and a suit, and I can kill every combine that I come against. So when the puzzle solution is shown, then a door opens beside you, and there you have the suit and two shotguns hanging.
Yes, that's the route I took. But the interesting thing was that I didn't know about that until I decided to select help. Did you do that consciously, or was that just something that you hadn't really thought about?
No, I did it on purpose, because just before the stealth part begins, you get the option to choose between a solution shown, or just go ahead and try to stealth your way through it. But when you choose the option of solution, then you're already not sure if you can make it yourself. And when I made it, I thought, well, I can also give the player a weapon at the same time then, when he wants to see the solution. Because probably he then knows how hard it is to get through. And maybe he will say, well, just give me a weapon, I go through it without stealth.
Okay, all right. It would be very interesting to know how many people went, you know, the stealth route and how many people took the shotgun, but... I suppose that's quite difficult, if not impossible, to know. There's no way of you recording a log or anything, is there?
No. It is a nice idea indeed, but no, that would take scripting or coding, I guess, and that's something I can't do. Baltic can do a bit of coding or scripting, but well, it's quite difficult, I guess, to learn that and to implement that. Right. I was thinking just the other day about playing that stealth part myself and making a movie of it, a small movie, and then place it on YouTube or somewhere else to show that it can be done, because there were some people that said that it couldn't be done, the stealth part, but it can be done.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure you wouldn't release anything that couldn't be done. I mean, I didn't have the patience for it. I know lots of people do. They enjoy that style.
Yeah.
All right, now, when we first started talking, you mentioned, you know, about making a game, and really that's where we've got to now. I mean, if assuming that you've finished with Source at least for a long time, what plans do you have for the future for mapping?
We're still not sure, and I'm still not sure. First, when Final Project ended, we still thought, well, this is the last that we do for now, at least with Half-Life, or Half-Life 2, Episode 2. And then we will... my cat is already... but before we started with Final Project, we already had the idea to make a game of our own, a first-person shooting game, but then it was too difficult and there were not good engines that were that user-friendly that we could use for it. But when Final Project was finished, we noticed that the UDK engine from Unreal was released. And we looked into that, mainly Baltic, and we looked into tutorials and the engine itself and the editor for a few weeks. But then we came to the conclusion that, it's a huge dream of mine to make a first-person shooter game myself. But it's not simply not possible. You need at least scripters and coders for it. And yeah, they are very hard to find, especially when they are good and want to work for many months on it.
Yes.
So we have left the idea of making a game of our own. And so we have to go back to modding again.
Oh, that's a shame, huh? I mean, not that I want you to go, you know. I mean, I'm happy for you to make a mod. But if that's your ambition, it's a shame that at the moment you can't realize it.
Yeah, it's just too complicated. You have to, because when you make a mod or a map pack, it's easy. Everything is there. You just use what you like. And, well, you can make some models of your own or skins. But that's quite easy compared to have to make it everything your own. And also the scripting that lies beneath it. And, I simply can't do that. And I need a few people who can do that. And it's simply said, it's not realistic to think that we can make a game of our own. That would stop after a few months for sure, and then we come to the conclusion that we still cannot do it. Mm. And well, there is nothing left other than modding. Although I would like maybe more to work into some kind of total conversion.
Okay. Going back to the game very briefly, did you look at other engines? I mean, I know that there are a few engines that are either very cheap or free. Did you consider some of those?
Yeah, well, the UDK, the Sandbox 2 engine, but that is not for indie developers, did Baltic tell me. And then on ModDB, I've looked through the long list of engines, and there are indeed a lot of engines. But some engines are not really capable for first-person shooting games, or are just not looking that good.
Okay, all right. So it's back to modding for you. Where do you think you'll go next? Crysis 2?
Yeah, that seems to be the obvious choice. I loved Far Cry. Far Cry 2 was okay. Then came Crysis. That was insane good. You do need a good computer for it, but when you have that, then it's really an amazing game. It's very realistic, and it's a first-person shooting game. It's a real first-person shooting game. So, because Crysis 2 will be released, I believe, in March next year, and that will give us time to learn with the Sandbox engine to work, and that we can do then with Crysis. And when then Crysis 2 is released, we are ready, and we know the engine and the editor so well that we can start immediately with it.
So is the editor available for Crysis 2 already? Is it the same editor for Crysis, is it?
I believe the engine is already released, yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, no, it's released. There are also people who are working with some assets of Crysis 2, I believe. Okay. That were, developers that already had proven with crisis mapping that they are worth something extra. And Crytek did release some programs or whatever to them. So, but the Sandbox 2 engine is released, yes.
Okay. But you mentioned earlier that maybe you'd like to move into total conversions.
Yeah.
I mean, that's almost as much work as making a whole game. I mean, how much thought have you put into that?
Well, it's I see it more as a step between modding and making your own game. It's about it. Total conversion is like that you make your own game, but you don't have all the troubles of coding and scripting. Although you have to do something. Well, it's whatever you add, you can make it as difficult as you like. But even when you don't want to script and code that much, then you can still use a game, and through total conversion, you can make it look like a total new game.
Hmm. I mean, would you start a new team? Not that you would stop working with Baltic and TBB or anything, but would you look to get some, you know, texture artists and modelers and things if you decided to go total conversion?
Well, a new team. This is the team that we have, and we like working together. And when there are people who want to join, they are always welcome. But it's very strange. Over the years, I have, I believe one or two requests from people who maybe could join. And then I said, well, you're welcome. Just show what you can do, and you can always help. And then after two or three meals, you don't hear anymore any of them.
Yeah.
So that's a bit amazing. I thought that more people maybe would like to join. And when you join this team, you're always sure that it will be released. You know,
yes.
Mods, they start and then it dies halfway.
Yes, exactly. All right, okay. So do you play most of the mods that get released?
When I'm making a mod myself, then I hardly play any mods at all, or games for that matter, because then I'm mapping a large part of the day, and late at night I play what I mapped that day, and then I'm so tired most of the times that I watch TV, then my eyes start burning, and so playing other mods. But when a mod is finished and I have free time, then I play whatever was released before that. And so, yes, I keep my eye out for good mods, and I don't play everything, but whatever looks a little bit good or very good, that I play, yes.
So what was the last mod you played for Source Engine?
1863 or something.
1187.
Like. 1187, that one, yes.
Okay, what did you think of it? I just posted it on Planet Philip today.
Yeah. Well, it does look great, and I believe it's 1.7 gigabytes big or something, insane amount of data. So it's clear that they did a lot of work, and it's looking good, and it plays great, but I still have some comments that most people did have on it. For instance, when you walk, the screen goes up and down a bit, and that doesn't feel right. That it feels strangely. And I also don't know why they did edit, because the walking scene of the game itself, of Half-Life 2, is good enough or great, so I don't see why they had to change it. And then I had problems with the knife. When you step on with the knife, that took too long and it didn't go well or something. It did feel strange, I can remember.
Yeah, me too. And I didn't like the knife very much.
No, no. And that was the problem. My main problem with it, I have to be honest, I didn't end it also. I did play it for 2/3 of something, I guess. Because after, in map 2 already, I believe you get a guy next to you, you know, that fights with you.
Yes, John.
Yeah, John, yeah. And I hate multiplayer game. Or I really hate it. When I play a game, I like to play single player alone. I don't know why, but when I have team members around me who starts to kill enemies that I like to kill, well, then for me, a lot of the fun is gone. And with this mod, it's not like that he walks in front of you and that you have to run to have to, that there is something left to kill for you.
Okay.
But still, he's always around, and I had some trouble in some tunnel complex or sewer complex that he was John had to be on some place, and then a gate opened somewhere. But I walked back and front with him, and after four or five times, then only the gate opened. But I know it's very difficult to get that right, so it's not a complaint. But well,
it is frustrating, isn't it?
Yeah. And my main complaint was that I didn't, set the time for how to play it myself. He was always at my side, John, and he took one third of the action, I guess. And I simply don't like that kind of gaming. And most new games are more and more like that. I hate it.
Yes, it's true. All right, well, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with me.
Yeah.
And I want to wish you and Baltic great luck, fantastic luck in whatever you choose to do.
Yeah, thank you. For sure we will come with a next mod or whatever. And for sure we will let it know also on Planet Philip.
Well, maybe by the time you release it, I'll have another website for Crysis 2. Who knows?
Oh, because I think it will be a great game and a lot of mods for it. So that would be a good idea.
Yeah, me too. Fingers crossed. Anyway, thank you very much, Leon. And have
no,
a great
you.
2010.
You too.